I ask that we waive the requirement to read the minutes, but instead just ask for a motion to approve the minutes of last year. Do I hear a motion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, very good, thanks. The minutes are approved. I'm now going to turn the meeting over to our president, Sid Martin, who will deliver his remarks.
Thank you. This is my fourth year as president of the ANS. I'm proud to be able to say a few words about the achievements over the last 12 months, and there have been many. As trustees, we have largely focused on developing a strategic plan, where we're going, what we're going to look like in the future, how we're going to get there. And this would inform our members and tell us what our plans are going to be. It would tell the staff, it would let the public know what to expect, us to become. And we're looking at about a five-year horizon in terms of this plan, and there'll be many things evolving during that period. I'm happy that we're making good progress on the plan, and we anticipate a final version within the next few months. Let me just explain in a few words the directions in which we're going. The American Numismatic Society's finances are fairly healthy, in particular in light of recent donations and pledges. We were also greatly pleased to see the recovery of over $2 million, which was owed to the society and which we had partially written off. It had been owed to us since 2008 when we sold our building downtown. We did recover that, and we forgave a certain amount of interest in order to recover that $2 million, and that has helped us a lot. Nevertheless, we are concerned by increasing salary and lease costs. As you know from previous meetings, the lease on this building rises quickly and substantially. It's at the level of approximately $1 million a year at this point in time. And since we have a lease, they're actually unavoidable in the future. Since the ANS leaves its headquarters, or left our headquarters, we will eventually also face the question in less than a decade of where our future home should be as the lease runs out in that time. Traditionally, the Society has operated as a mixture of museum, library, and research institution, and since our move to Hudson Square in 2008, we have tried to fulfill all of these functions. Over the last few years, we have seen a marked change in how members and the public at large use the Society's collections and headquarters. With ever more sophisticated internet access to libraries and museums, institutions like the ANS have realized that an accessible location is still important, but that most of our visitors are now engaged in virtual visits to our website. As you will hear in the report of our Director of Publications, we had 250,000 visitor sessions from people in 196 countries over the last year, whereas the number of actual physical visitors to the ANS numbered only 840. And that included groups of school children as well. At the same time, our beautiful New York City home cost the Society, as I said, over $1 million a year. Inevitably, one wonders whether the Society's resources shouldn't be spent differently and on a less expensive space. And we have begun actively looking at what considerations might be for that. A second issue that we have to address are membership benefits. Our membership numbers have been decreasing slowly. They've been ebbing off over the years, where our impact on numismatics and museums has increased enormously by every metric we can come up with. The problems that we face are not uncommon in other learned societies. While members in the past received a journal and a newsletter by mail, tangible membership benefits are now much more difficult to devise when journals and access to collections or libraries are now basically free online. The Society has been one of the key proponents of open access databases, but we have noticed that it is hard to persuade members to join when everything else is free in the open space. So the staff has begun to develop a few programs for members here at the Society and that we hope will attract new members that don't rely on access to the free part. In the context of discussing our future and a strategic plan, we examined our mission statement, which was rather long and overly elaborate. It was almost a Elizabethan in form. However, we believe that the proposed revision voted on by the fellows represents the society's mission more appropriately. Our annual meeting always provides the opportunity to thank our very many supporters who contribute their time, books, and most importantly, their money to the organization. Here our trustees should be mentioned first, and at this meeting, it is my duty and pleasure to express our gratitude to the trustees, many of whom are in the room now. And we'd also like to particularly express our gratitude to three trustees who are electing to step down. If I may have slide one, Jeff Benjamin has served on the board for 9 years, and his contribution has been invaluable. From 2012 to this year, he served as treasurer and chairman of the Finance Committee. One of our most important positions, it was, but in many other organizations, it is often a thankless task. He oversaw our endowment and worked closely with our investment consultants and the staff. I'm personally most grateful for his service to the society. We're most fortunate to have had the benefit of someone so actively involved and successful in the world of finance. And Jeff will remain involved with the ANS. His other activities, it was important for him to step off at this time. Slide two. Richard Bellison. I'm looking, this is the first time I've seen the picture. He has been a steadfast supporter of the society for many years. I believe he's been on the board, I think, for 6 years. Based in California, Rick has been an early supporter of the Sage Society, and we are extraordinarily grateful for his financial support to the society. It's been just really amazing over the past years. We all remember his wonderful surprise gifts. He'd just come in and here's a surprise. Okay, and that was really, really good. He gave gifts in honor of Abraham so far, and later a most generous gift to the endowment of the executive director's chair, which we are actively working on. Rick's love of sports is well known, and we wish him all the best. It has been really a pleasure and an honor. Slide three. Doug Rohrman has been on our board for over a decade and served as the first vice president from 2008 to 2013. His dedication to the institution is exemplary. As an attorney, he has played a key role in governance of the society. As chairman of a committee that redrafted our antiquated bylaws, he helped reshape the society's legal structure. We will also miss his measured approach to the rather trying matters in the field of cultural property, which we really will miss him because they remain. On behalf of the trustees and the staff, I express my warm appreciation to all three of these individuals. We are fortunate to have found three outstanding candidates who are willing to serve as trustees and will hopefully be voted on today to replace them. It goes without saying that I'm also pleased that we are surrounded by such an impressive board of trustees that helps in so many ways. I would like to highlight John Nebel for his most generous support this year, which has allowed an overhaul of our complete IT and server system. Larry Schwimmer has also shown great generosity, as well as another anonymous donor. My gratitude to all of you. I want to close by thanking our chairman, Ken Edlow, without whom we would not be where we are today. And again, I would like to send my thanks to you for coming and attending the meeting today. And now I'd like to welcome to the podium Bob Kandel, Chair of the Nominating and Governance Committee. Bob.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to conduct and present motions to be put to you as fellows of the Society. Fellows of the Society represent a maximum of 225 members of the Society. This is both life fellows and honorary fellows. As of this afternoon, we have 219 fellows, seven of whom, unfortunately, are not eligible to vote today because they're not current with their dues. If you're here, please see Joanne in the back and become current. It's important to vote. I am pleased to report that pursuant to Article 3, Section 1 of the bylaws, two associate members were elected as fellows of the Society at this morning's regular meeting of the Board of Trustees. We'd like to welcome Mr. Mike Dunnigan of Fort Worth, Texas, and Mr. Eric Goldstein of Williamsburg, Virginia. We will now proceed with the business of the election of trustees and other matters. Fellows of the Society are entitled to vote at this meeting. As per Article 4, Section 6 of the bylaws, 20 fellows present in person or by proxy shall constitute a quorum. All fellows who are present today have been asked to sign in. Will those fellows who are present but have not yet signed in, please sign in now with Joanne in the back again. Okay, we'll assume everyone has signed in. And if anyone is holding a proxy, please present them now also to Joanne. Okay. May I have two ANS members who are not fellows of society volunteer to count the proxies? One. And do I have a second? I need a second. Thank you, Peter. While they're counting proxies, let me tell you the names of the following nine trustee candidates who've been nominated for re-election or election for a term ending in 2019. Perhaps those trustee candidates who are seated here this afternoon, if you'd please stand as I mention your name. Mr. Keith Barron, Dr. Andrew Burnett, Ms. Beth Drescher, Michael Gasfoda, Professor Kenneth Harl, David Hendon, there we are, Ms. Mary Lannan, thank you, Larry Schwimmer, and Mark Tomasco. Welcome. Would a fellow second these nominations, please? Thank you, Jay. Will those fellows who have not mailed in or handed in their proxies earlier, please raise their hands in approval of the nominations. Okay, Joanne's counting. Are you good, Joanne? See, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17.
17, okay. Good.
We're going to have 17. Thank you very much. You put your hands down.
And we have 84
cards. Okay, and that meets the requirement of our quorum. Okay. Can we now report the outcome of the election? Yes, everyone who was nominated has been elected. Now, Uta or Joanne, we just covered that.
Yeah.
We're done. All right.
Total.
Thank you. The trustees have been elected. Our next order of business is for the fellows of the society to vote on the recommendation that has been made pursuant to Article 16 of the bylaws to revise Article 2, the mission statement of the society. Sid just spoke about our future and strategic plan, including a proposed shorter, simpler mission statement. The current mission statement is displayed, and rather than having me read it, I'll just pause for a moment. The proposed mission statement has been skinnied up and states, the mission of the American Numismatic Society shall be to promote and advance the study, research, and appreciation of numismatics. May I have a motion to amend Article 2 of the bylaws as described?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Aye.
Thank you. Is there any opposition? Hearing no opposition, the bylaws have been amended accordingly. I want to thank everyone. I want to thank the members of my Nominating and Governance Committee, and now turn the meeting over to Ken Edlow with the report of the Treasurer. Thank you.
Peter, I think I have the next slide.
Sure.
Okay. I'm delivering the Treasurer's report for fiscal year 2016, which ended on September 30th. I'm very happy to report that for the fiscal year that just ended, the Society's investment portfolio had earnings of $2.37 million. That is a return of slightly under 6%. During the year, we withdrew, coincidentally, exactly that amount of money to fund our operations. Nonetheless, we were able to increase our endowment because we were paid, as Sid said, $2.02 million for on this Kent Swig note, which we had as a result of the sale of the William Street building in 2008. We also took in another $291,000 that were restricted towards the executive director chair. The result is that at the end of the last fiscal year, our endowment total was $41.35 million, up from $39 million at September 30th, 2015. With respect to these endowment funds, over the summer, the Finance Committee decided to end its consultancy arrangement with LVW, which had been in place for about 7 or 8 years. And in its place, the ANS hired TIA Cref and Douglas C. Lane and Associates to manage the bulk of this ANS portfolio. Our switch was precipitated by the deteriorating performances of various hedge funds and partnership products that LVW had recommended that we purchase. The Finance Committee decided that the ANS would no longer invest in such products as these, which have limited saleability and typically have long lockup periods. Instead, the Finance Committee decided that henceforth, the ANS's endowment would be invested in a diversified portfolio of fully liquid equity and debt securities having minimal management fees. We also revised the ANS Statement of Investment Policy, and the policy now provides that the portfolio should consist of approximately 70% in stocks and 50% in fixed income product. 30%, sorry. Okay, can we go to the next one? Yeah. All right, you're all paying attention anyway. All right, here's slide two. All right, so during the fiscal year, the ANS received contributions from members and friends totaling $568,000. In addition, our gala netted us another $133,000. And we received grant monies totaling $104,000. These three items add up to $805,000, and this covered approximately 22% of our $3.6 million annual costs. The rest of the money was basically taken from the endowment. That represents 78%. Now, expenses in fiscal year 2016 came in $26,000 under budget. But nonetheless, we had an cash operating deficit of $460,000, but we were able to finish the year with an actual profit and loss gain of $983,000 because we booked a $1.47 million accounting gain when we made that $2 million recovery on the Swig note. For fiscal year 2017, which has just begun, the Society will, of course, earn money on that $2 million that we recovered from the Swig note, which we didn't have available to us a year ago. And in addition, we've been fortunate enough to receive a pledge of $250,000 from an anonymous donor, of which $225,000 has already been received in fiscal year 17. So given the outlook, we believe the outlook is for a much smaller deficit in any event for fiscal 2017, and we're cautiously optimistic in that regard. In closing, I just want to thank the members of the Finance Committee for the time and effort that they've devoted to the Society's financial affairs. Now, Uta Wartenberg will continue with the report of the Executive Director.
I'd like to welcome you all, and it's a particular pleasure to greet those of you who may have not attended as such an annual meeting, and that includes some of our new staff members. Don't know whether they're visitors, but it's always nice to see so many familiar faces as well. At this occasion, this is when we look back at the last year and take stock. And you've heard from our president and treasurer already about the overall direction of the society and its finances. The staff will present their own report, and my report over the years is becoming shorter and shorter because the staff really presents it so much better, and we have also so many more people working here, which shows that things are going the right way. It's also the extraordinary breadth of expertise that is represented by this individual staff member, although it is still a very, very small group. I also shall give you some ideas how some of the members here have helped with our work, which is another really important element of this. Staff is one thing, the help from the members is invaluable. And so people come from volunteering to researching to reading for the journal. It takes all sorts of forms, and there are really very many people. In fact, most people here in the room, I know we reach out to and ask for help, and I cannot really say how important this is, and that without all of you, and I won't list you all, it would be really difficult for us to function. And Sid highlighted as well as Ken, you know, how important the financial support is, and even, you know, membership dues count there, and it is really important. Do I do the slides?
Excellent.
And one of the ways how we get support is through the Sage Society, and, you know, we just came back from a wonderful trip to Poland. We organize such a trip every single year, and we've visited a great number of places. And we were particularly enchanted, you know, by the splendors of these towns. Our hosts were a number of our Polish colleagues, Alexander Brusz, Jarosław Bodzik, Adam Dengler, and very many students who all helped the society. It was all free of charge. Really, it's that sort of support we get also from people really from quite far away that is really most appreciated. The history of Poland, a country that has been divided up so often and governed by other nations and so on, came really alive, and some of these pictures here show us, you know, we just visited really a great many things here. And we were able to meet many of the coin curators, which is something that always happens in visit museums online, but it was also, we met with various people, such as the vice president of the National Bank of Poland and various university rectors and people. And I think those of you, and there's some people here in the room that went along, we were really, as ANS members, treated like sort of minor royalty, and it was really a great trip. And this is sort of little plug. It costs only 2,500. Many of you are members and not actually making use of this, but the trips are not, you know, wildly expensive. And it has also been suggested today to maybe include a sort of weekend trip to an American location that more people may take part in. So, but we are planning our next trip. We don't quite know yet where, and we always usually do this by suggestion that people come up saying, how about going to such and such a place? So if you have any ideas, that would be good. Some of you obviously can perhaps not take part in these events, but we are also trying to improve for our regular members the program that we have. And going forward, we will have seminars once a month, which will provide general introductions to a wide variety of areas, and this is really aimed at some of our members, and I don't know, I don't see too many in the room here that think of, but we have a lot of members here in New York who are new collectors, and they quite often come to the events, and we're trying to help them, and it'll be an event where the curatorial staff and some of our members will give introductory seminars where coins will be handled and will be followed by, you know, a little bit of drinks and food afterwards so that people get to know each other. So in addition to this, and this is by popular demand, and today was the first of these Saturdays, we also try and keep the ANS open on at least four Saturdays in the year to see whether there is enough demand. Those of you who've been members for a long time in the ANS will remember that it always was open on Saturday, but there came a point when virtually nobody showed up anymore. It might be quite different now as more and more young professionals are joining the society here, and so we will try and see how this will be taken up. Over the last year, and coming to a slightly different part here, our several rather prominent members of our society passed away, and I would like to take a little time to remember them here, as well as their contributions to the society and the field overall. There's a picture of them all. In early January, our trustee, former trustee Daniel Holmes, here in the left-hand corner, passed away at the age of 77. Dan was one of the really great collectors of early large sins, and this is putting it mildly. He had an extraordinary collection and was really passionate and was very involved in the EAC and really a very much beloved member of the community. Despite suffering for very many years of SEL Lou Gehrig disease, he kept in touch with the society, called Joanne or me, and he would always say, "Holmes from Cleveland." And then we knew he wasn't well, but he, you know, donated regularly. He was a donor to his death, and he'll be really greatly missed. Chad Krause, here, one of the most famous American numismatists, and I'm sure all of you saw that he passed away at the age of 92. His field, the influence on the field of collecting, I'm not the person to describe that, and the many obituaries gave really excellent accounts of this. He was, what is perhaps less known, a very generous donor to this organization, and in recognition to his contributions, he was added on our donor wall, but he had also made a very, very significant donation, one of the largest donations to this particular build-out, and his name was therefore added to our vault. And this is the picture of one of his last visits. He used to come quite frequently in the last years and sits in the office, and we go out to lunch, and he'd tell me long stories. And at one point, it came up how his name had been taken off his own business as it had been sold. And that was something that he found very upsetting. And so I said, "Well, you know, you're always going to have our vault." And so we took this picture, and he really liked that. You know, it really was something. But he won't be forgotten because, you know, his catalogs, as all of you know, everyone refers to them as Krause catalogs, whatever people might call them. I will personally miss him enormously. He was a real presence in the last 10 years in my life, and you know, very, very sad. Now, Leon Lacroix is the individual here that you see sitting here, and I believe he was 105 when this picture was taken. People all think that Eric Newman was our oldest member, but that actually is now correct, but was not correct until Professor Lacroix's death on 1st of August, when he died at the age of 107. He was born before World War I in 1909 in Belgium, and he's best remembered for his work on Greek numismatics, a very famous scholar, and his work on Greek statues, archaics and Greek statues on coins is still one of the most consulted works in that area today. It was published in 1949, and in fact, I was surprised to discover a few years ago when Eric turned 100 that this gentleman was confirmed to be alive. But I've never met him, but I had always admired him for very many years, so it was really a great thing. Another European member that passed away that quite a few of you in this room would have known, who was really a very dedicated A&S member, was Harald Salvesen from Norway, who had one of the great collection of Athenian coins. And he'd been a very frequent visitor. Unfortunately, he was a very private man and didn't engage in internet photographs, so we have no photo of him here. But I would like to highlight two here in the left-hand corner, a really tragic death of one of our members of the colonial community, Jeffrey Stevens, who I only met once, who was killed by a drunk driver on Interstate 95. At the age of 45, I mean, really a very sad loss to the community. And then, of course, something that very close to many of us in this room, Tom Sederland, who died shortly, in fact, after the San Francisco Bulls last year, very unexpectedly on the 16th of December. He's a person that I've known ever since I came to this country. I'd have heard of him before, and his knowledge and love of coin and the number of people he got involved in coin collecting is something that was really very remarkable. And I know many, many people will miss him. And he was a faithful A&S member for many years. I'm turning now to Professor Frederick Armstrong, one of our longstanding members from Canada. And he passed away. Born in 1926 in Toronto, Professor Armstrong taught and researched 19th century history at the University of Western Ontario. He joined the A&S in 1947, and over many, many years, he donated regularly to the collections, as well as small cash contributions and so on. And on his death, we didn't know this, Professor Armstrong left the society a very nice legacy from his estate, which coming from the Canadian end is not so common. And we're incredibly grateful to these individuals, and this is quite frequently, and I'd like to highlight how often members who might not be extraordinarily wealthy leave these legacies, and we encourage really all members of the A&S to do that. And we have a number of academic members, such as, for example, Professor Nathan Elkins, who has made a very significant commitment in his will to the society that is extremely large. And this is really a very easy way, and you can be any age. Usually people think of this as older, but Professor Elkins is in his 30s, but he clearly thought you can never start early enough, you might be run over by a bus, as he put it to me. And you know, it is something that a lot of academic institutions, you know, not everyone can give large sums of money you know, when they're alive, but you know, something like this, it's certainly appreciated, and we noticed this, and we've had a number of these donations and estates over the years. But I'd like to end on a very happy note, and I would like to wish the very happiest birthday to our two great Islamic curators, and I believe both of them are here, Mike, or formerly Dr. Michael Bates. Mike, happy, happy birthday on your 75th birthday. You were clearly hiding from us because, and then Peter Donovan, or Dr. Peter Donovan, who of course works also in the Islamic collection and you know, is still a volunteer curatorial associate, turned 80. And you know, this is really for us, it's quite wonderful to have people here that, you know, reach the milestone, because it seemed to be a little, you know, having everyone, you know, the estates and death notice seem to be not everyone dies. Most numismatists, as you've seen, are extremely long-lived, and therefore I continue to praise this. This is always a point I make. This is my report of the executive director, and our director of publications, Andrew Reinhardt, I'm afraid had to go on a trip to Israel rather unexpectedly. And therefore, I will be giving his report of publications. And I think I'll just click now. No. Yes. The A&S published 3 books in the past fiscal year, Monuments in Miniature, Architecture on Roman Coinage by already Nathan Elkins, wonderful book sitting out there. The Banknotes of the Imperial Bank of Persia, An Analysis of a Complex System with Catalog by Michael Bonan and edited by Jerry Bachrach, to whom I have to extend our warmest wishes. He's at the moment in hospital, that's why he cannot be with us, but he edited this book because Professor Bonine actually passed away before the book was even, he finished the manuscript, but the book wasn't finished, and Jerry edited is perhaps a euphemism because he finished writing it, and it is an amazing book. And then Irritamenta, Numismatic Treasures of a Renaissance Collector by John Connolly. It is an extraordinary book, and title might be a little bit not clear what it is, but it is one of these books that, for those of you who are interested in provenance research on ancient Greek and Roman coinage, they will see from this Harvard manuscript that is probably from the Venetian family of the Laurdans, that you can even identify coins that are in drawings and identify the current specimens. Since the book has appeared, people have already highlighted a few coins that are in there because these are so rare, and these give them basically a 15th century provenance. There are very few such manuscripts that are there, and it is a really wonderful book written by one of the greatest scholars in that field. Forthcoming, almost any moment, Wealth and Warfare, The Archaeology of Money in Ancient Syria by Frédéric Durat, a very timely book on hoards and other things. It's a very academic book, will be published on November 4th, so it's really any moment. And two other books will be published by the end of 2016, and it's Peter could tell you, will tell you more about The Art of Devastation, edited by him and Patricia Fagan, and a book that I have worked on for a few years, which will go under the author of Wolfgang Fischer-Bossert, Coins, Artists, and Tyrants, Syracuse in the Time of the Peloponnesian War, which will be a completely new study of the coinage of the signing artists of Syracuse, replacing the old Tudea book. Peter van Alphen produced another four issues of the ANS magazine, and Andrew Reinhardt continues to create and publish the digital edition for members to read online on any device. It is always an extraordinary amount of work, and really grateful to Peter for producing such an amazing magazine, which is really our main membership benefit, and I know many people enjoy reading it. The American Journal of Numismatics is currently under the shared editorship of myself for ancient material and David Yoon, who's here for medieval, Islamic, and Asian, and modern submissions, so we divided it up. AGN was just published earlier this summer, and AGN 28 is already at the printer and will ship in February. So there was a little bit of a delay because of the change of editorship from Andrew Meadows to David and myself that caused that delay. But now we're already in target for the year after, and we're very pleased that we get so many excellent submissions, but please do consider sending things in. I would like to acknowledge the efforts of Oliver Hoover and some others, as well as the many readers, and they have brought this journal now back on track. Colonial Newsletter is also under new editorship with Christopher McDowell at the helm, and his first issue will be printed in November, tipping the scales at over 60 pages. So if you're a regular reader, you will know this, but you might consider really looking at this and subscribing. It's an add-on to your regular membership. But publishing is more than just printing and books of books and periodical. It strives to fulfill the ANS's mission of disseminating numismatic scholarship to as wide an audience as possible in as many ways as possible. This includes digital publication. Someone's phone here, sounds nice. Our most important publication is our own website, numismatics.org. That has undergone a complete transformation over the past few months. And thanks to the efforts of Ben Hipner, and we all know how hard Ben worked at this, those of you who have worked with him, the ANS has now a more modern website with better functionality and an easier way to find what people are looking, and we're still continuing to improve that. Numismatics.org is the world's portal into the collections and activities of the ANS and is our most widely read publication. This is really how Andrew sees it, and he's correct. The website is the home of major collections and projects, including our largest undertaking, online coinage of the Roman Empire, referred to as Ochre. And as we near the end of this project funded by the NEH, the ANS, under the guidance of Ethan Gruber, has, as of this week, over 100,000 Roman imperial coins combined from our numismatic partners worldwide. These coin records are all tied to every volume in the Roman Imperial Coinage series and are provided as a free resource to anyone interested in the Roman Empire. It is an extraordinary achievement. I'd like to also acknowledge Andy Meadows, of course, our former director, who was the person who wrote the application and managed this at the beginning. Similar smaller efforts proceed with the ANS's online homes for the coinage of the Republic online, and I won't list them all there, but there is a whole number of similar websites sort of incorporated, and that includes something, for example, from the numismatic material, the publication of the Egyptian National Library, which is hosted on our website. So it's not all ANS material. All of the new numismatic data are cataloged under the standardized vocabulary established by Nomisma.org and the Nomisma Steering Committee, an international group of scholars working together to ensure data consistency across the whole of numismatics. These online collections both supplement and complement the ANS's own massive collection, which can be researched in Mantis, which is our collections database, which records links to searchable online archives held in Archer. This is the archivist material, and our library. So the idea is that eventually there will be one overarching way of searching our whole collections. All this is provided free of charge to anyone who wishes to explore our data. One other resource free to researcher is the ANS's digital library. And this is something you might really not have seen or heard of. So we have a little bit more here. The digital library contains unpublished numismatic dissertations and theses. It also contains scanned ANS monographs, most of which are out of print or difficult to find. These searchable scans were paid for through the 2016 Humanities Open Book Project grant from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. The ANS was one of 8 scholarly publishers to receive funds for this project, the goal of which is to rescue and resuscitate out-of-print and rare books, publishing them online at no charge to the reader. The ANS took this one step further, converting the scans into pure data that can be read on any device in any format. Not only that, but this converted data facilitates the linking of ANS publication and scholarship to the work and publications of other researchers in other institutions, create a web of knowledge hitherto impossible to achieve. By actively promoting open access scholarship, the ANS plays its part in the 21st century interdisciplinary scholarship, removing all barriers to entry. This is a point that's particularly important for those of you who are collectors, because traditionally it was actually quite difficult getting into libraries that are not always free to the public. Our open accessibility has not gone unnoticed, and Sid made already a reference to this. In the past fiscal year, numismatic.org received over 1 million page views from nearly 250,000 sessions. Visitors from 196 countries came to numismatics.org over the past years. It's always a great list when you look at it down. You know, you wonder, in some obscure countries, there's like 2 visits. You think, who is that? Why is he not a member? For our own online project, Ochre was used by over 32,000 people who spent an average of over 5 minutes per session searching for Roman imperial coinage. 37,000 people used Mantis to search our own collections. You said that, as Sid said, you said that against how many people come and actually physically look at this. You know, it shows what our outreach is and you know, how we try and get to people. Not all numismatic publications need to be scholarly, and it shouldn't be. To that end, the ANS continues to conduct outreach through social media of every variety. Coin images are posted to Pinterest and Instagram, and the ANS promotes its work via Twitter and Facebook, reaching thousands of people each day. Our YouTube and Vimeo channels host the ANS's lectures, in fact, this event, hello, given over the past couple of years. And this has become extremely popular, and as a member, you get the link where to look for this. Our Pocket Change blog continues to explore the ANS's collection and introduces the people behind that research. So the ANS Publications Program has created the new traditional model for communicating our mission and for sharing our collections and its attendant scholarship. We are excited for the future, and this is Andrew speaking, but so are the rest of us, and we are creating that future now. It's a very Andrew's sentence, and that ends his report. And I will now hand over to our newly elected Vice President, Andrew Burnett.
Thank you very much, Uta. I shall be brief, naturally, in a long meeting. I just wanted to say hello. Not everybody, I don't know everybody in the room, and I'm sure you don't all know me, and say thank you very much to the fellow trustees, and indeed the members more generally, for allowing me to potentially play a much greater role in the affairs of this society, a society I've known for over 30 years now, since I first came here in the early 1980s as a visiting scholar, and which I've admired for all that time and followed its history with great interest. The position that of second vice president, bit of a mouthful, traditionally has been held by someone with an academic background, and I see very much my role on the board in this position as being the guardian of the academic and curatorial values of the society. Not that those values need any real defence or guarding, as they're much appreciated by everybody on the board. And I hope that given my own lifelong career at the British Museum, to be able to bring something of an international perspective to it. And it's very important that we do remember where we sit in a broader world. And we've all heard this afternoon of how the ANS itself is increasingly becoming less of a US and more of an international organisation. Well, being, as it were, a guardian of the academic values of the society is not, as I say, a difficult role to play. We have the most wonderful resources available for us, a fabulous collection, one of the best in the world, probably the best numismatic library in the world, and as we've been hearing, increasingly more and more wonderful electronic resources whose usage is, as again you've heard, being taken up by scholars and more just people generally interested in coins, again, all over the world. All this, of course, is the work of the wonderful staff who work at the at this organisation. You know, trustees can do a little bit, but it's up to the staff what really happens. And again, that makes such a role as I will have a very easy one, because I think it's very easy. It's quite clear that, without exception, all the staff are very skilled and have achieved enormous things. You've heard something of the publications, but everybody in this organisation contributes to it in a very real way. And it's, I would say, organisations I've known, it may be small, but I've known few organisations that have such a sense of supportive spirit amongst the staff as this one. So I look forward to hopefully a slightly longer association with this with the ANS, and I wish it well for the future. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I think I know most of you here, but I'm Eshel Kreider, and I'm told there's a little lag with my slides, but there they are. And my job is really to thank you. So The truth is, all the work that's done by the wonderful staff here is really done in partnership with you, because your donations and your membership dues actually contribute to about half of the million or so dollars that we brought in through contributions this year. If you're paying a lot of attention, you'll notice that the numbers are fluctuating a little bit from one report to another, but that's because we look at gross and net. Your support is really very significant to the health of this organization, and it's really with your partnership that we're able to move forward. I don't know if you know Catherine DeTore, who's in charge of membership here. She's here today. She might be outside, but if you don't know her, I hope you'll say hello. I work together with her for both development and membership, and if you have any questions about anything, we're both always happy to speak with you. Half of those contributions, as I said, come in from the membership, both in your donations and your dues. But in addition to that, we've been raising money for a special campaign that was already talked about a little bit, that's called the Campaign to Endow the Chair of the Executive Director. This year, we received about $291,000 towards pledges that have already been made, which brings us to about a little over $700,000. We have pledges in of over $1 million, as you can see. But this campaign actually is for over 5 years, and it's to raise approximately $4 million. So anybody who'd like to talk to me about how they can be involved or contribute, or other people they might know who might be interested, I'd love to speak to you about it. Our membership renewals, again, have been keeping pace with last year, but haven't really been growing. I was hoping today I could introduce you to one of our newest members who joined recently, but I guess he wasn't able to come, who's 14 years old. And we are reaching out to not only the next generation, but even the younger generation who seem to be interested in numismatics and history, and are coming to us, I think, to a large extent because of our online presence. But we're hoping to see more and more people here at the ANS. So there's the thank you. And for anybody in this room who hasn't renewed yet, come see me or Catherine, and we're happy to take your money. One of the things that we have done here is we have a lecture series. This year we had the Sylvia Manning Herder Memorial Lecture, which was given by Dr. Alram. He was also the recipient of the Archer Huntington Award. And we also had the 2016 Fowler Memorial Lecture, which was given by Dr. Ellis Evans, who is a junior research fellow in classics at Queen's College, University of Oxford. But as Uta mentioned, the Society plans to roll out a new series of seminars that will be done by the curators and others, and not necessarily so esoteric, but more broad-based, so the people who aren't numismatic scholars would be able to enjoy and benefit from them also. You'll notice I'm repeating a lot of things that have been spoken about a little bit today, but these are some pictures from the trip to Poland that Uta spoke about. The trip to Poland is open to ABSS members. It's a contribution of $2,500 a year, but in truth, it's a significant way to support the society. So whether you go on the trip or you don't, it is a tax deductible donation to the society. It's a wonderful group of people, many of whom are here today, and they could talk to you about what it means to be part of the society and some of the trips. And as Uta mentioned, we are discussing having more local trips, trips in the United States, which would be more affordable and maybe more accessible, shorter trips if people can't make this kind of commitment in terms of time to take out a week or so to go abroad. One thing that hasn't been talked about yet today is the gala. And this past year in January, we had a wonderful opportunity to thank one of our major donors, John Adams, and his wife, Regina, for their long-term dedication to the ANS, John's leadership roles as an ANS trustee and active committee member. They're incredibly generous to society, and they made them a perfect choice for the 2016 Trustees Award. John Adams also received the Archer Huntington Award in 2014. I think he is the first person to have received both awards, as far as I understand. It's quite prestigious, but he really, both of them were a tremendous draw. We had almost 200 people at the gala, and a lot of people told us that it was one of the most enjoyable events that they've been to. We also recognize Kenneth Bressett with the ANS Distinguished Service Award, and Dr. Ursula Kapman received the 2015 Burnett Anderson Memorial Award, which is given in conjunction with the American Numismatic Association and Numismatic Literary Guild. That brings me to 2017. Our gala will be this year on January 12th, which is a Thursday. It will be held once again at the Waldorf Astoria in New York. One of the big differences this year is that those of you who fly off to Florida for the fun show have no excuse. The fun show is the week before our gala, and so we expect all of you back and at the Waldorf on January 12th. It's obviously in conjunction with the New York Ink Show, and we really hope that you will help us make a great event this year. It's a bit of a challenge because last year really set the margin quite high, but we need your help. We hope you'll come. And in this year, we're also honoring Eric P. Newman Numismatic Education Society and the Newman Numismatic Portal with the Trustees Award. And this is a well-deserved recognition of all the family has done in partnership with the society over the many decades. And Eric Newman, of course, also. So we may have honor a few additional people. We're still in the process of putting the event together. We'll have more information about it probably in the next week or so. But we really hope you'll attend. Uta alluded to some people who unfortunately passed away this year. One of the things I wanted to talk about a tiny bit is the planned giving program. It's a little bit under the radar here. We haven't been very aggressive about asking people to think about us and make a bequest and mention us in their wills, but many people have done so. And the image on the left is actually a letter from a member, from the estate lawyer of a member, who made a bequest in his will of $1,000 to the ANS in March of 1885. Now, I don't know if that date resonates with anybody here, but the ANS was actually founded in 1885, so this is probably one of the first bequests that we have. 58. Oh, 58. Well, I reversed the years. I reversed the numbers, but luckily I'm not the accountant here. I'm just trying to raise the money. Still, $1,000, if I do the math properly, is probably around $25,000 with inflation now. But truly, it's the gift is really more valuable if you think of the donation as a testament to the member's faith in the society and his desire to leave a legacy for the future, which indeed he did. The other image is an excerpt from a donor who made a member, a fellow who told us this year that he was leaving his life insurance policy to the society. So this has come in 131 years after the one on the left. And I think that that tells us something about the faith that our members have in the society, in its longevity, and in their faith in our future. And I just want to quote, I mean, you can read it, but just quote briefly, that this gentleman said, with an academic salary and student loan repayment, It's improbable I'll be able to make a truly transformative gift during my lifetime. Planned giving is my way to pay it all back to the ANS. So I hope that these inspire you to think a little bit about the future of this society and the young people like the 14-year-old member that we just got who'll be coming here 20 years from now and making the same kind of donation for the generation after him. And my final slide is simply just to thank you again. And I pass this on to David Hill.
Okay, thank you, Eshel. For those of you that don't know me, I'm David Hill, the ANS librarian. Okay, and I would just like to start by looking at some of the researchers that have come in the past year into the library. As always, the summer seminar was a particularly busy time, and every year it's a pleasure to work with these scholars, and it's extremely rewarding to see these collections get such great use. In fact, it's usually fall before we get all of the books and journals and auction catalogs and so forth back onto the shelves. Some of them still probably are, haven't been. Of course, researchers come in to use all different kinds of materials too, including our archival materials. This is architect Lucretia Benilliure, who came in to use the records relating to her great-grandfather, a sculptor and medalist who contributed to the ANS's International Medallic Exhibition of 1910. And ANS member Chris Baycraft has several times come in from Arizona to work with the ANS photo file, which many of you may be familiar with, which is a massive card index of pre-modern coins that was begun in 1915. The photo file is currently in several locations in the building here, including in the basement. In fact, the photo file got some use today, as a matter of fact, because some of it is in Andrew Reinhardt's office. Of course, there are those that come from a lot further away. This is John and Glennis Cook of the Australian Numismatic Society, who came in to use some pamphlets and periodicals from their organization that were unavailable to them at home. And we continue to welcome these visitors, but I am also pleased to report on the great progress that we have made on a project bringing the materials of the ANS library to scholars and other users around the world. A year ago, a scanning operation was set up here at the ANS as part of the Newman Numismatic Portal, with the aim of putting a significant portion of the library's holdings in U.S. numismatics online. The project is fully funded by the Eric P. Newman Numismatic Education Society and administered through Washington University in St. Louis. So far, the library's U.S. auction catalogs have been the main priority, though the books and archival materials are also beginning to appear online too. The Society began collecting auction catalogs in its very first years and early on claimed to have the most complete set in existence. This collection has been used to produce several reference works on this topic, notably a two-volume work by John Adams that was published first in 1982. I am pleased to report that there are nearly 3,000 of these catalogs now online, and there's plenty more to come. This is John Grafeo, who operates the scanner. John is actually employed by Internet Archive, which is a nonprofit provider of digital content that works in partnership with the Newman Numismatic Portal. So nearly all of the 3,000 or so catalogs have passed through my hands before they reach John, because it is my job to prepare the metadata, including the assigning of actual titles to replace the dates that have been used as titles in the past in our catalog. So after John completes the scanning and makes all of the adjustments necessary, he uploads them to Internet Archive, which I'd like to stress at this moment that it is separate from the Numismatic Portal. I'll make this point in a moment, but there are really two places that these show up, and they will eventually show up in the Newman portal, but they immediately go onto Internet Archive, and I'm going to attempt to demonstrate this here on this next slide. Okay, so this slide is animated here, and I'm just going to take a look. The Internet Archive is broken down into these libraries, so one of the things, if you want to find these catalogs, one of the things to do is to, you can search for American Numismatic Society, find our library. You can see it at the top here, so you can just choose it. And then for the most part, these are catalogs. As I say, you see a book here. Other things are coming online, but for the most part, you can go right into these catalogs. These are all ANS catalogs. fully searchable, as we'll see here in a moment. One way that one often searches catalogs is to search by date, so we're going to do a date search here and pull up a specific catalog and look at it. Okay, actually two from that date. So we're going to choose this one here. Now, of course, you can look into the catalog, but first, let's look down. And some of the metadata here, you can get more information. Some of our cataloging that comes directly from our Donum catalog is in here. If you open up this drop down here, you can get more information. And of course, you can go over here and you can download this and use it on any kind of device that you'd like, or you can download it right to your computer as a PDF file. So you have a lot of different options here. Or you can just read it right on screen. You can page through here, of course. Or you can search within each one. For example, we know that this one contains an $1804 dollar, so we're going to search for that. And all of the results will appear along the bottom of the page here. And then there's a great deal of information here. We can go directly, there's a photograph of the $1804 dollar. All kinds of other information. There's actually, when we get to the final two here, there's actually two more catalogs that had to do with the $1804 dollar that were sold in this catalog. And I believe, yes. Okay, so that's it for Internet Archive. Okay, Newman Portal. Okay, most of the scanned, as I said, most of the scanned ANS material also appears on the Newman Numismatic Portal itself, which is separate from the Internet Archive. And as I say, the idea is that most, that all of this material will eventually be in the portal. So I have a more brief demonstration of the portal here. One way you can look for items in the portal is you can go right down here to auction companies. And this will demonstrate that this is one of our catalogs is actually in here. So we're going to look for a Woodward catalog, so we're going to go to W. We can just browse right to the one that we want. And now that we've found it, we can open it up. And okay, you can see from the bookplate here, that's from us. So this is one of our scanned catalogs. But these catalogs will immediately appear on Internet Archive within days of John scanning it. So, we are very excited about this project, but it's not the only one involving auction catalogs that we've devoted our time to. In March, the Society auctioned off 93 duplicate foreign auction catalogs through CNG, realizing a hammer total of nearly $5,000. A great deal of work has now gone into the preparation for the next sale, and hundreds have been checked and packaged, and detailed listings of the catalogs have been compiled using a database format provided by CNG. And after the addition of some condition information, they will be ready for sale. Longtime library assistant Arnie Tesher has seen here helping to organize the auction catalogs, which has been a great, quite a large project and with a lot of different people involved. He was employed for a few hours during some weeks to work on the project. Arnie also continues to work and volunteer his time helping out with archival and other projects. This includes the processing of a previously uncatalogued collection of 19th century letters discovered buried under some materials on a shelf in the rare book room. So these had not been, these were not to be found in our catalog, so they were kind of, I was kind of excited to uncover these. They had been sent to an obscure Coney Island dealer named George Mason and were written by such notable numismatic figures as Sage, Hasseltine, Mickley, and Antonelli. I've already used some of this information in the letters for an upcoming ANS magazine article on the Society's auction catalogs. And over the past year, I made use of the library and archives for several other articles, including one on numismatic showman Farron Zerbe, featuring some of his correspondence from the ANS archives, and some of which documented a disagreement between him and Texas dealer Max Mell. The 100th anniversary of Anna von Hyatt's statue of Joan of Arc provided the opportunity for another article Vaughan also produced a Joan of Arc medal for the ANS and sculpted statues for the Audubon Terrace, and was already a successful sculptor at the turn of the 20th century, years before she married ANS benefactor Archer Huntington in 1923. She lived until 1973, nearly to 100, working well into her final years. The Society's collection of art medals relating to Angelo Mariani and the popular wine that he sold throughout the world in the late 19th century and early 20th century was the subject of another article. It was also my pleasure to give a talk on the history of the ANS to the New Jersey Numismatic Society last month, and I was honored to be asked to contribute to a special issue of the Asylum on the future of numismatic, literature. The library's halftime cataloger, James Woodstock, and other assistants have added an average of over 100 items to the catalog each month. James also catalogs individual articles and books and 27 regularly received magazines and journals. In addition to new materials, we receive regular donations that we process, including this year from the Institute for the Study of the Ancient World, the U.S.-Mexican Numismatic Association, and the Numismatic Society of Puerto Rico. With all of this work, we were fortunate to have had the assistance of four library interns over the summer and fall to help us with the cataloging and various projects, all donating their time to further the work of the library while also gaining experience with rare books, library cataloging, and the library's day-to-day operations. We would like to thank Tiffany Kamuski, Michelle Krokmalny, Irene Elias, and Antonia Peachin. And finally, I would like to thank everyone who has donated to the library this year. Your contributions are always greatly appreciated. I'm happy to say I could, once again, not fit all of these into one slide. So here's another slide of people we would like to thank for all of their donations. And now I would like to turn it over to our Greek curator, Peter Van Alphen.
Afternoon. Let's see. All right. There we go. it's another Alan Roche creation here. Wonderful job, I think. All right. So, as many of you know, this year we saw some significant staff changes in the curatorial department. U.S. coin and currency curator Matthew Whitman departed in February after less than a year with us to accept a position at Harvard University in their library system there. And this actually really gave us an opportunity to rethink our staffing and curatorial needs in terms of our overall financial situation. And what we decided was that instead of hiring narrow specialists to cover only one specific area of the collection, that from this point on, all curatorial staff will cover a variety of areas in which they're expected to curate, undertake research, and serve members of the public. And in fact, this more or less reflects what has been going on in the curatorial department for the better part of a decade anyway. And this will now allow us to focus on neglected areas of the collection and catalog new acquisitions, in particular whole collections like the recent Rick Wachonki collection, with a great deal more efficiency. So among the new staff changes, we welcome Gilles Bronsborg, who has actually been with us for a number of years, but now officially is an ANS curatorial staff member. He came on board on the 1st of September as an associate curator, and his purview will be the Roman collections, which he's been overlooking for a while, but in addition, the coinages of the Americas. David Yoon, who has been with us for a very long time, in fact, David Yoon has been around longer than I have, which I think now about 15 years or so. David Yoon, we finally got him to agree to accept a curatorial position, something we've been trying to get him to do for a while now. He also has come on board as an associate curator and is going to be dedicating his efforts to our growing collection of medieval and early modern European areas. This year, we also hired two limited-term staff members, Mr. Vivek Gupta and Dr. Lucia Carbone, who are working on areas of collection that also need a great deal more attention. And you'll have a chance to hear from all of them in just a moment. But at, right now, I also want to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Peter Donovan for his many, many years of service to the ANS. In fact, for well over a decade now, Peter has been overseeing our Islamic collection after Michael Bates retired, and he has been working tirelessly on cataloging and reordering much of that collection. And as he is now stepping back from some of these responsibilities, I think that it's only right that we acknowledge what he's done for us and also give him a healthy round of applause. So, Peter. So I want to just give a very quick overview of what the curatorial department has been up to this year. As has already been mentioned by Uta and Andrew Reinhardt through Uta, a great deal of our curatorial energy this year has again been devoted, along with that of our digital scientist, Ethan Gruber, towards this suite of web-based projects. And as you can see here, and as people have discussed to some degree already, what we have started to build here is just an amazing set of tools to aid in research. Most of these tools, such as Ochre and Coin Hoards, or online coins of the Roman Republic and Pella and so forth, are essentially typological tools that also aggregate material from other collections. So you're able to go in, you're able to find coins of a particular type, get a set typological description, find examples of that particular type from our collection, from other collections, but then in some cases also get a significant amount of hoard evidence and increasingly some archival evidence as well too from the ANS's archives. In time, this will be just, it already is an amazing set of research tools, but it will increasingly become even more so as all of this becomes more and more interconnected. And if you haven't already done so, I really do encourage you to spend a few moments, go online, and take a look at what these are and what they do. And as the three-year, $300,000 grant from the National Endowments of the Humanities for Ochre comes to an end in early 2017, we're happy to report that all of the project's milestones have been met, and Gilles will tell you about this in just a moment. And the overwhelmingly positive response we've been getting for all of these digital initiatives has really encouraged us to push on with still more of them. And so this next year in 2017, we're planning to begin work on a project called Hellenistic Royal Coinages, which will serve as an umbrella site for linking either existing sites like Pella or soon-to-be-launched sites focusing on the Ptolemies and Seleucids as well as Alexander the Great into a larger cohesive unit. So do stay tuned. Now, of course, most of these digital projects require high-quality photographs and precision cataloging of the thousands of objects in the ANS collection, in part because these projects are fed through Mantis, which is our online database. So again, considerable attention this year was focused on recataloging and photographing objects in our collection to make sure that this is all of the highest standard. So our photographers, Alan Roche and Emma Pratt, added images of over 23,000 objects to our website this year. And this is where you can find this on Mantis, which currently has over 138,000 objects with high-resolution images available, which represents about 22% of the entire collection. So clearly, we have a ways to go, but we're certainly making a great deal of progress. Now, because of the overall Greek and Roman focus of many of our digital projects, it's those two areas that, again, this year saw some of the greatest gains in terms of both the cataloging and the photography. And as you can see from this area down here, there are some areas of the collection which are, you could say, underrepresented. And should you have any desire to see greater representation, I would encourage you to perhaps make a donation towards pushing hard with the photography in some of those areas. So when we're not pushing hard on the digital fronts, we in the curatorial department have contributed to make, or continue to make, a pretty substantial number of academic contributions to share our knowledge with the larger academic community as well as with interested people. And so again, this year we, I'd say, distinguished ourselves with a pretty prolific number of publications and presentations of research. this little tally that you can see right here. And this also includes work by Oliver Hoover and David Hendon, who are also on our curatorial staff. Those of you who are interested in seeing what we've been up to, you can certainly check out our academia.edu pages, where you can download a great deal of our work as well, too. And I would certainly encourage you, you know, to take an opportunity to visit these pages and avail yourself of our work. All of the curatorial staff members, again this year, along with Uta Wartburg, Andrew Reinhardt, and David Hill, participated in the Society's primary education program, the Eric P. Newman Graduate Seminar in Numismatics, which is held for 8 weeks during June, July. This is our numismatics boot camp. And this year we had 8 students, including the first time we've had a student from mainland China. And I have to say this was really an outstanding group of students this year, and some of their work will be appearing in the not too distant future, I hope, in AJN as well as some other publications. Our visiting scholar this year was Klaus Vondeweg from the Kunsthistorisches Museum in Vienna. And again, we had curators emeriti Michael Bates and Robert Hogue, along with Ted Withington, our long-term volunteer, give lectures in the seminar. And I'd really like to thank them again for their efforts in helping us put together this really outstanding program. And of course, as usual, Alan Roche, our photographer, put together a really great class photo. And as you can see, this is the unofficial version of the class photo. You can find the official version online and elsewhere. Moving on, my own work this year has been focused again on these digital projects, including Pella, and also getting this new project, Hellenistic Royal Coinages, underway. And I do have to say that just in this last week, we've had a substantial push into Pella of new material from the Ashmolean Museum and some other institutions. And we are now approaching over 15,000 objects in Pella, which is a new milestone. So, you know, do again check that out. In addition to Pella, I've also been trying to wrap up a whole stack of publication projects that won't go away. And this includes the volume White Gold, which I'm editing with Uta Wartburg and Chaim Gittler, as well as a rather fun project, Art of Devastation, despite the title, to say this actually is a pretty fun project, on World War I medallic art. And this is an exhibit catalog that I'm co-editing with Patricia Fagan, which is also an exhibit catalog for a show that we are going to be unveiling in January at Vassar on World War I medallic art and related poster art. So you will certainly hear more about this in the coming while, so do stay tuned for that. And with that, I would like to turn this now over to Gilles Bronsberg.
Thank you, Peter. Good afternoon. So I guess I should do this and this. Very good. So I will start with Orker. You've heard a lot about this project over the past 2 years. Our main focus has been to bring online all types of Roman imperial coins ever produced, and we are close to completion. Behind that task, there are some, it looks like easy, there are 12 RIC catalogs as books, and you put the coins online. Actually, there is a lot of work behind the scene, since coins from RIC are usually poorly standardized, and the publication of these books have extended over a period of like 70 or 80 years with very different methodologies. So one of the challenges was to make them standardized from a computer point of view or an internet point of view. At the same time, some of our own coins were poorly cataloged, so we had to review them and modify or amend many ANS coins. This year has been a record. We had 20,000 new types incorporated into the database and about 11,000 individual ANS coins photographed. I'd like to stress the leading role of our director of data science, Ethan Gruber, notably in spearheading the integration of physical coins provided by outside collections. And these are some of the names with the number of coins they contributed. We are close to 100,000 Roman coins right now, so physical coins available and photographed in the database. What's truly spectacular is when you think about the number of coins we know from the Roman Empire, there may be around 1.5 or 2 million Roman coins at most known worldwide. So we've had 1,000, we are somewhere close to 5% of all Roman coins that have been excavated, found, and collected, which are now available online. When the I'd like to stress one of the contributors, that's the portable antiquity scheme in England. It's only 345 coins, but they have north of 100,000 Roman coins in their own database. So once these coins migrate to us, it's going to be a massive influx of new images of Roman coins, particularly 3rd and 4th century. So moving forward, I'd like to thank all these contributors, and notably the British Museum and the Berlin Münz Cabinet. We had a graduate from Columbia working for us as an assistant, a curatorial assistant for 1 year, Lorenzo Manelli, and Emma Pratt as an assistant photographer, who have played a key role with respect to this achievement. We have we are now displaying almost 44,000 types of Roman imperial coins, so almost everything by now. Number 9, so volume 9 of RIC, was catalogued by our German partners, the Deutsches Archaeologisches Institut, with David Wigwolf. The next major, well, there's still one, okay, it looks like, yeah, the bottom of that slide, so it's a small image, but that's something we're working on in order to complete the Ochre project. We're going to add, Andy used to call that, Andy Meadows used to call that the coins of the idiots, but it's not at all pejorative. It's, you have a coin, you don't know what it is, you may read a couple of letters, you may have a sense of the image on it, maybe worn, maybe corroded, and by having a kind of database of images, and by having a way to enter the letters you can see, or the space you can see, the system will help you to narrow down the number of possible types to a manageable list. And our colleague Disnada Pinaglia is involved with Ethan and myself in completing this last part of the project. So the next project that will kept us busy this year and next year is dealing with a major donation of our late colleague, Richard B. Wiczonki. Rick, gave to the ANS more than 3,700 coins, mostly from the transition period between the Hellenistic time and the Roman times. Some of them are extraordinary, very rare, for example, the Cleopatra issues from Syria, or the so-called fleet coinage of Mark Antony, where the ANS now owns about 25% of all known coins of that type as a result of that donation. So with Elena Stolajnik, we organized all these coins on trays, and then hired another Columbia graduate, Douglas Wong, who did a preliminary cataloging through a large Excel spreadsheet. And now our new colleague Lucia Carbone will take over the core of that project. Now, among the publication activity that Peter mentioned, that includes on my side a paper in the Annali, the Italian Annali di Numismatica, published by the Instituto Italiano. There will be as well a paper published in Germany. There are as well, a forthcoming paper on 6th century taxation in the Journal of Late Antiquity, and a chapter in a book, Late Antiquity in Contemporary Debate. Among the conferences, so we have Collège de France, Université d'Orléans with Roger Bagnall, a conference at the Instituto Italiano di Numismatica and Instituto di Storia Antica, as well as ISO and Columbia. But I'd like to stress one roundtable I was part of at Yale a few months ago. This roundtable was sponsored by the Economic Growth Center with the support of the Business School, which may provide us some ideas how to outreach outside of the numismatic community itself and connect coins with a wider monetary policy or economic policy topics that are intrinsically linked to coins and banknotes. At the end, so for next year, we're looking for the completion of Orker, pursuing the cataloging of the RBW collection that will lead to a book. With Peter Van Alphen, we're going to do some teaching at NYU next year, this spring, actually, and hope that there will be, another opportunity to outreach outside of a narrow number of members through the staff lecture series that have been promoted by our executive director. Thank you very much.
Well, many of you know me and have worked with me in one capacity or another over the years that I've been working with the ANS, but I am now working specifically in the curatorial department with the medieval and modern coins of Europe, principally. And over the past year, the largest task occupying my time has been the former Hispanic Society of America collection, specifically the medieval Spanish coins. Two important groups were donated to us over this last year. A large group of Visigothic regal coins, and also some important early coins of the Kingdom of Castile and León. For both of these donations, I spent a great deal of time preparing lists with correct attributions to help the process of having them appraised for donation, and creating the new accession records for the coins after they were donated. And I would just note that the 584 Visigothic coins, this is just one of a series of donations from a very generous benefactor, and that those 584 coins in themselves would be the largest collection of Visigothic coins in the world. And this process continues with more Visigothic coins and more Castilian coins, either newly donated or in the process of preparation for donation. Now, the medieval department has mostly been in our database system since the 1980s, but a few portions were skipped during the initial cataloging. During the past year, I completed the accessioning of our Merovingian coins in connection with researching and writing an article about Merovingian coins for the ANS magazine. In contrast to the medieval department, substantial portions of the modern department have not yet been accessioned. During the past year, I worked with an intern, Taylor Hartley, who accessioned parts of two of these sections, Italian emergency paper money and Dutch jetons. Now, in addition to non-numismatic research, such as the Bova Marina archaeological project in Italy, my ongoing research focuses on the pseudo-imperial coins that imitate late Roman imperial coins, but were issued under other authorities, in this case, the Visigothic and Burgundian kingdoms of southern France and Spain during the 6th century. The principal focus of this work has been a detailed analysis of trajectories of stylistic change. But work during the past year has also included dye studies of two of the three well-recorded hoards of these coins. Now, in addition to our own research, an important part of our curatorial role is to assist other researchers who wish to make use of our collection. Besides working with a number of visitors studying medieval and modern coins here, I've had the pleasure to see some new publications appear based on outsider research with our collection. And I might point here to publications by Chad Leahy, who visited the ANS to study the types of coins circulating in Spain at the time of Cervantes, and by Luigi Ferruglio, who made use of our collection for a study of the emergency coinage used by the Venetians during the Ottoman conquest of Cyprus in 1570. And finally, my work on ANS publications over the past year has included the editing and production work for the banknotes of the Imperial Bank of Persia by the late Michael Bonine, as well as editorial work on the volumes of the American Journal of Numismatics for this year as well as next year. Thank you.
I joined the ANS curatorial team as the Adler Family Assistant Curator for Ancient Coins in September 2016, so I'm the most recent addition to the curatorial staff. Earlier this year, I received a PhD in Classical Studies from Columbia, and with a dissertation focusing on the impact of Roman imperialism on the monetary and administrative systems of the province of Asia. So really the topic, basically, of the Wuchonke collection. So, as you can see, exactly, among the other tasks, the Adler Family Assistant Curator of Ancient Coins will primarily assist the American Numismatic Society curators in cataloging, researching, and publishing the Wuchonke collection, as we said. And as Gilles has already said, in the course of 2016, the whole collection has been preliminary cataloged. I have to say that since September, we have entered 700 coins into the spreadsheet, so which means that now we are absolutely done with the preliminary cataloging, thanks to exactly to Emma Pratt for the photography and Doug Wong. And as we know, as we already said, the comprehensive catalog of the collection will be published by the end of 2017, hopefully, or the beginning of 2018. Okay, you see here the trays about which, of course, Gilles has already talked, and you here see some numbers. It's pretty impressive, and you see that, you know, the number, you see the number of coins, and of course, this is my specific love that I inherited from Rick, but you see that ANS already holds the largest historic collection with almost 750 pieces, and this collection adds 445 coins. So we are the best collection, basically, about it. So it's fantastic. So the Wuchonke collection, and I will see what we're going to do with it next year, apart from the catalog, of course, is an incredible research and educational tool. I taught at Columbia for several years and also in a high school teacher, so education is really one of my focuses, and so that's why I'm super interested about, of course, the romanization, the beginning. So there are several elements that are fantastic about this collection, as you know, and of course the relationship within Roman and provinces, not only in Asia, which is of course one of my focuses, but for example in Sicily and so on. So what are the next steps with the Wuchonke collection? Okay, so of course the publication of the catalog, the organization of an international conference, which will go probably together with the catalog, the organization of an exhibit, possibly the graduate course at Columbia University that I will teach in fall 2017, and the outreach to Italian museums, especially Sicilian ones, for the publication of similar collections, and of course Thai studies ongoing on unpublished coins included in the collection. One of the ones I'm actually doing that and will probably appear exactly this year, because I'm going to submit it, is this one on the history of Tralles, and this is my personal homage to Rick, because I began this work with him during the summer seminar 2012. So as you see, it's like 476 coins, and Rick had the biggest amount of this Sistoffer in his collection. I mean, 53. I mean, there's no other single collection with such a thing. So, and we will publish, we will actually publish, we'll present this in the AIA annual meeting, where me and another colleague, which is Irene Soto, so another alumna of the ANS summer seminar, will exactly present on this, and of course I will present this history of Tralles. So thank you, thank you for this, and of course I leave to leave after us.
So I'd just like to echo what Peter said about Michael Bates and Peter Donovan. It's been really a pleasure to join the department. And, you know, they've been caring for the material for so long, and it's, you know, we wouldn't be where we are without them. So again, it's really wonderful to join the department. So I'm going to quickly go through what I've been doing. So I was brought on really to clean up the database and make make our database more searchable. The Islamic and South Asian coins comprise about a quarter of the collection. A lot of it is uncatalogued. Most of it is under photographed. So I've been moving at larger scale changes, but also doing smaller scale changes. So if an exhibition happens, I enter inscriptions. Inscriptions are now going to be entered in Indic and Islamic scripts. And in addition to sort of these day-to-day things, I've been also conceiving of three specific projects. The first one has been to promote the ANS archives. The ANS has been a center for Islamic and South Asian coinage with curators who have set the standard in the field. I published an article in the ANS magazine drawing attention to George Miles' work and legacy, especially in light of the recent Seljuk exhibition at the Met. A second project, which is really tied to my research, has been on Mughal mints and Indo-Islamic coinage. I've also been inspired by ochre to develop a similar platform for Mughal coinage. This has involved creating numisma identifications for new locations and collaborating with our photographer to ensure the accurate documentation of these works. Related to the ANS's Indo-Islamic coinage, I have organized a lecture at the ANS on May 1st, 2017, where we will be welcoming Professor Philip Wagner from Wesleyan University, and his respondent will be Finbar Barry Flood from the Institute of Fine Arts. A third project is on Islamic glass weights, which will hopefully be a catalog and an exhibition. To highlight the extent of the ANS's Islamic holdings, I've conceived of this project tentatively entitled Light and Weight, Imitation and the Itineraries of Islamic Glass. There are approximately 5,500 Islamic glass objects in the ANS's collection that shed light on broader issues of material culture, scientific innovation, and decoration, and our colleagues, Michael Bates in particular, as well as George Miles, have published immensely on this material, and it's time that it receives its due. My own publications and lectures, I have two articles coming out this year, one in Archives of Asian Art and the other one in the Journal of Arabic Literature. I'm giving a lecture series in Bombay on Islamic aesthetics, as well as participating in an international conference on Mughal art and culture, where I will be presenting research related to Mughal mints. So that's all, and I'm passing the torch to Elena Stordic.
Good afternoon. I'm last in this list. I hope you enjoy my colleagues' presentations about our curatorial department activities. Each of these projects is based on research with our famous collections. That is why it's so important, from my opinion, continue to enrich our collections with new interesting items. And I'm glad to report that during this fiscal year, the ANS Coin Cabinet acquired over 1,500 objects through generous gifts as well as purchases. Although we can show you today only a small selection of these items, I would like to express my deep appreciation to all of our donors who continue to fill gaps in our collections. We acknowledge and thank them all. I cannot read because it will take a lot of time. Our benefactors, Abraham and Marian Schoers Affair, continue to develop our collection of ancient Judean coins. This fiscal year, this affair's donation, and they donated over 270 examples. Important highlights include a Ptolemaic silver hemidrum with Paleo-Hebrew inscription, a coin of Herod the First with the first graven image on a Jewish coin, and a coin of Herod Philip that is the first coin struck by a Jewish king with his own portrait. The ANS is great to add over 300 important items of Holy Land coins from our adjunct curator, David Hendon. Among the interesting objects acquired are a silver obel of Gaza, imitating Athenian type, a very rare bronze proto-Judah Aristobulus, the first ruler of the Hasmonean dynasty to declare himself king, and a fine portrait coin of Tigranes V, king of Armenia and a descendant of Herod V. A remarkable donation came from INS fellow Jonathan Kagan. It's a unique silver tetradrachm of the Sicilian mint of Camarina. The reverse of this coin bears an artistic innovation. The head of Heracles faces left, but turned slightly to front, and from this perspective, the lashes of his right eye can be seen. I hope you can see this. I just enlarged it a little bit. We are very grateful to our longtime member, David Mitten, Professor Emeritus at Harvard University, for an important group of early Greek electrum and silver coins, and to our fellow Edward Alvors, Professor Emeritus at Columbia University, for a gold tila of Shah Murad struck in Bukhara. A generous gift came from our fellow longtime volunteers and devoted friend, David Feinstein. The core of his donation is a group of bronze coins reflecting David's interest in the Roman provincial mint of Nemausus in Gaul. We are extremely grateful for donation from a very generous benefactors, like David Yun mentioned, of 584 coins of the Visigothic king from the former collection of the Hispanic Society of America, formed by our past president, Archer Huntington. With this gift, the INS collection of Visigothic coins is elevated from the largest in the Americas to the largest in the world. This group covers almost the entire range of Visigothic's regal coins, from the first coin with the name of Leovigild, you can see this on the top, to those of Vitiza, the penultimate Visigothic king in Toledo. The medieval department also received from the same generous benefactor another large group from the former HSA collection, 189 early Spanish Pelon coins from the kingdoms of Castile and León. ANS fellow Robert Sheff has presented us with a beautiful gilt bronze medal dedicated to distinguished Italian composer Giuseppe Verdi, designed by a famous Swiss sculptor and medalist Johann Baptist Frenner. The collection of our medals issued by the ANS has been improved by a gift from the Society fellow Scott Miller. He donated a pair of uniface bronze casts of the original design submitted by Marcel Jouvin for the ANS 125th anniversary medal. This design was later replaced by a new design of Marcel Jouvin. All are familiar with this new design. However, 12 sets of original cast medals were commissioned from the artist by members of ANS committee. We are glad that one of these sets has now, after so many years, added to the collection. Better late than never, I think. I'm sorry. Another aspect of our curatorial department activity is the ANS Museum Loan Program. Currently, around 431 objects are out on loan to 15 permanent and 6 temporary exhibits, and our curatorial staff usually provide consultation service for all borrowing institutions. Here are some recent highlights. In early April, 4 bronze coins from this society were lent to the Art Institute of Chicago for the exhibit A Portrait of Antinous in Two Parts. This exhibit brings together a broken portrait of an exceptionally beautiful Greek youth who was a favorite of the Roman Emperor Hadrian. I believe many of you are familiar with this story. Our coins demonstrate iconographic features that were likely inspired by sculptures of Antinous. In April, the Metropolitan Museum of Art unveiled a spectacular new exhibit, Pergamon, and the Hellenistic kingdoms of the ancient world. This exhibit brings together some over 264 artworks from the multiple world-famous museum. The ANS has lent to this show a remarkable silver decadrum of Porus and two silver tetradrums struck in Babylon. And our executive director, Ute Wartenberg-Kegan, gave her paper in a great symposium, which was organized in conjunction with this exhibit. Another interesting exhibit, Court and Cosmos, the Great Age of the Seljuks, also was opened in April at Metropolitan Museum. This was the first major exhibit to present the art of Seljuks, a Turkic dynasty that in a short time conquered a vast territory stretching across the present-day Turkmenistan, Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Turkey. This exhibit featured 13 coins from the ANS, including gold dinars of 11th century, as well as copper coins that show artistic borrowing from earlier Greek, Roman, and Byzantine coins. You can see on the bottom of this slide. A special exhibit, Roman Myth and Myth Making, featuring over 60 coins from the ANS collection, opened in September at the Joint Art Museum of Gonzaga University. It's a private Catholic university in Spokane and Washington State. This show explores how the Roman choose to interpret their mystical religion past through iconographic presentation on everyday objects. ANS coins in this exhibit show Roman gods and allegorical personification of imperial virtues. An exciting new exhibit, Time and Cosmos in Greco-Roman Antiquity, opened in October, just a couple weeks ago, in the Institute for the Study of the Ancient World of New York University. The exhibit explores the ways time was conceived in the Greco-Roman world, and ANS items include over 40 coins and gemstones, which illustrate celestial phenomena, astronomical deities, and zodiacal symbolism, as you can see from enlargement. In conclusion, I would like to take a moment to express our sincere and special thanks to the curatorial department, very valuable volunteers and devoted friends, Ted Withington and Ken Adlow, and also to our intern, Taylor Hartley, for their priceless help and generous assistance with many, very many curatorial functions. We also must acknowledge Robert Hogg and Michael Bates, our devoted friends, for their continued substantial involvement with society as emeritus curators. Lastly, in conjunction with this meeting, the ANS curatorial staff has installed in our gallery a new display dedicated to a history of old money and our new exhibition acquisition. And we hope you enjoy this small exhibit and it will encourage you to make further donations, which in next year maybe will be on this display. Thank you very much.
Well, before I close, and you see now this year most of our staff, there are some people here that don't get quite such a front role because they do that sort of behind the scenes work, but they should really be acknowledged because without them nothing would happen. And I'd like to start with Natalie Jordan, our Director of Administration and Finance, and there she is. And her colleague who keeps the book so beautifully, Barry Bridgewater, who isn't here today. Garfield Miller, who is probably running around cleaning up again, who does. And of course, Joanne Isaac, without whom nothing would happen here. And there are a number of other people, you know, that make all this possible, but that isn't quite as obvious to say. And there was one piece of news that reached really, you know, this only after the meeting, and this has to do with our forthcoming gala that Eshel reported on. And I'm particularly very thrilled to say that the Board of Trustees voted today to
award at the same event as with the Eric P. Newman Foundation, also to add our beloved friend, and all of you know him here, Tony Terranova. Piece of news that had to do that we didn't discuss at our last board meeting because we didn't realize the fun show. He was one of these people that always chose fun over us, but this year we can induce him, and I'm personally so thrilled. So this remains just to thank you all for coming, and I thank all the staff and really everyone that helps with this organization, and come again soon and enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you very much.